for the next 30 minutes, we just see some of the basic aspects of IVUS imaging. Started with the imaging system, then a few words about how these IVUS images are produced, and the important part, interpretation of IVUS images, and end up with some artifacts. I have not covered anything related to IVUS guidance for interventions. I thought maybe it can be a big topic by itself. So just to stop with image interpretation, maybe if you have time, next webinar, we just discuss how to use IVUS imaging for simple and complex lesions. So to start, some basics, coronary angiography we use extensively in practice. And it helps in visualizing the entire coronary anatomy with a single contrast injection, helps in identifying disease, helps in decision making between surgery and medical treatment and PCI. And as we all know, this is a pathway to intervention. Then why do you need an intravascular imaging once you get all the information from coronary angiography itself? However, the coronary angiography is a luminogram. It provides only a two-dimensional image. Does not provide any information on the vessel wall, such as plaque distribution and extent, vessel remodeling, and the plaque composition. In addition, it is limited by foreshortening, overlap, and angle dependency. So this limits its capacity to quantify the stenosis, sizing the reference vessels for stenting, and it is again limited in correctly estimating the stent expansion and apposition. More importantly, it is less sensitive for detecting post-PC complication. That's why even though coronary angiography still remains a primary modality for decision-making and guiding our intervention, we need an additional modality to understand better what is happening inside the vessel wall and inside the stent. So start with some important things about imaging systems. The imaging system has three parts. One is the console. Console is the source of electrical energy for the transducer. In addition, it also serves as a display monitor and also a storage device. So three functions: provides electrical energy, display, and storage. Then the second thing is your motor drive unit. Motor drive unit is responsible for the revolution of your IVUS catheters, so rotation of the IVUS catheters. And this is a pullback device. This pulls back IVUS catheter at a constant speed to produce the longitudinal images and length estimation. The third part is your IVUS catheter. IVUS catheter has a small transducer mounted at the tip, and which is responsible for your image protection. And how does this ultrasound system works? The basic principle is not different from any ultrasound imaging modality such as echocardiography. The console provides electrical energy, which is delivered to the imaging catheter and the piezoelectric crystals. So this electrical energy is delivered through the catheter to the transducer. Transducer has piezoelectric crystals. With this electrical stimulation, these piezoelectric crystals produce ultrasound waves, which get reflected from the tissue interfaces. And a part of it is collected by the transducer. And again, it stimulates the piezoelectric crystals, converted back into the electrical signals. These electrical signals are received by the IVUS console, which decodes into the tomographic cross-sectional images. There are two type of IVUS systems. One is a mechanical, which has a single transducer element, which goes around the circumference of the vessel to produce the 360 degree images. And the second one is spaced array system, which has an array of 64 elements mounted on the tip of the catheter. Each one gets activated serially. Rather than it is rotating, here the 64 elements, they get activated in series to produce sequentially to produce the 360 degree image. So this is how the IVUS images are produced. And some more information about interaction of ultrasound waves with the tissues. So before going into this thing, we have to understand two terminologies. One is the tissue interface. Tissue interface is the border between two media where there is a change in acoustic impedance. So the second thing is, what is acoustic impedance? That is the resistance to the passage of sound in a medium. So that is your acoustic impedance. The interface is the border between two media. There is a change in the acoustic impedance. So when this ultrasound wave interact with the tissue, so what happens further? That is decided by three important features. One is, what is the angle of incidence of this ultrasound wave with the tissue interface, whether it is perpendicular or less than perpendicular. The second thing is smoothness of the surface, whether this interacting surface is smoother and regular or an irregular surface. And the third thing is, what is the difference in the acoustic impedance between these two media? These are the three important determinants of the ultrasound wave interaction with the tissue interfaces. So here we see an example. Here this ultrasound signal, which is perpendicular to the surface, which is smooth and regular. So this results in all the reflected waves going back in the same direction to the transducer. So smooth, regular surface and perpendicular interaction, the reflected waves goes back to the transducer. So almost all the waves back to the transducer. Okay. So what happens further? So further transmission of the wave into the next interface is determined by the acoustic impedance difference between the two media. If this impedance difference is very large, most of the ultrasound waves are getting reflected from the first interface itself, and less amount passes to the next interface. If the difference is small, and most of the ultrasound waves are allowed to pass through the next interface, again, the same thing happens in the next interface. And again, the same properties, the difference between the impedance goes to the third interface and gets reflected. So this is on the regular surface. Suppose if the surface is not regular, but still the angle of incidence is perpendicular, there is something called scattering occurs. That means the ultrasound waves are reflected in different directions. So this is called scattering. Only a small amount of scattered reflected wave reaches your transducer and helps in formation of your image. Suppose your angle of incidence is not perpendicular. What happens? It just gets reflected at the same angle. So if it is 30 degree of incidence to the vertical line and get reflected at 30 degrees up to the opposite direction, and doesn't result in formation of any image. So it doesn't participate in the formation of image because it is reflected away from the transducer. Suppose the surface is irregular and it gets scattered similarly, and part of this wave is reflected back to the transducer for forming of the image. And what happens in the transmission part? If there is a big difference in the speed of sound between these two media, these waves get refracted. That means it just get bent and goes in a different direction. Usually these refracted waves do not participate in the formation of the image. Sometimes when they get reflected, they result in artifacts. So this is the basics of the interaction of ultrasound waves with tissues. And in addition, two other things you have to understand. What are the two things which produces shadowing, or it is the poor visibility of the deeper tissue? The two things. One, when the acoustic impedance between these two media are very large, as I explained early, all the ultrasound waves get reflected from the surface itself. So nothing goes into the second interface. So that causes shadowing, where you can see only the leading surface and remaining things are shadowed. So this is this phenomena is called shadowing. The second phenomena is called attenuation. Attenuation is nothing but decrease in the strength of the ultrasound wave when it travels into deeper into the tissue due to mainly absorption or reflection in different directions or scattering. So these are the three things: reflection in non-perpendicular direction, scattering, and mainly absorption, which converts the kinetic energy to heat energy. So that result in poor penetration of ultrasound waves into the deeper tissue. This phenomena is called attenuation. So these are the two phenomena which result in poor visibility of the deeper tissue. What happens when the ultrasound reacts with the tissue or we react with the structure which is smaller than its wavelength? That again results in scattering of the ultrasound waves. So this results in speckling. Most common example is RBCs. If you have a slow moving RBC, that results in speckling inside the lumen. So this phenomenon is called scattering. Okay, so now we have seen shadowing, attenuation, scattering, and reflection and backscatter. And moving forward, how does the image is formed? So image, for forming an image, you require two information. One is where exactly is the particular structure is positioned in the tissue architecture. And second information is what is the brightness, how much is the reflectivity of the that structure. Here you can just see that in the first interface, it is depth information is given by the time taken for this ultrasound signal go to the interface and get reflected and come back to the transducer. This travel time gives you information of depth. We all know the science velocity of the sound is 1540 meters per second. When this is multiplied by this travel time, you get the depth, means the length it has traveled. That gives you the depth information. Here, it's shortest this first interface, shortest distance it traveled. Then it is much more than first interface, and this wave traveled much more than. So this will reach us early, and it is delayed, and it is further delayed here. So this will provide the depth information. And then second thing is, what is the intensity? What is the strength of the reflection? Higher the strength, the structure appears brighter, and lower the signal strength, the structure appears darker. So that they call as reflectivity. Better reflectivity, brighter structure, and poor reflectivity, the darker structure. Okay, and this is how this information is translated to images. Here you can just see this is the depth information. It is the derivative from the pathway travel time, so flight, the time of flight, so of the ultrasound waves. Here you can just see that this point, this wave has traveled for long distance, intermediate distance, and short distance. In addition, we also provide the intensity, that is the intensity of the reflection. This is a brightly reflecting tissue, overly reflecting tissue, and again brightly reflecting tissue. Each one in different depths, and each one has a different intensity. This forms one A line. So we all know it is the ultrasound image is the, it is the amalgamation of multiple A lines. So this is first A line, and ultrasound catheter image the next part, next A line. And this is the third A line. So this is how the images are produced. Here you can just see that how it happens. It forms multiple A lines. So the catheter moves around, it produces A lines here. And this is a deeper structure, intermediate structure, superficial structure. This is bright structure, dark structure. This is again bright structure. Good reflectivity, poor reflectivity. So this is how ultrasound images are formed in intravascular ultrasound. And some of the basics about ultrasound image. The ultrasound images are analogous to histological section. They produce images not, it is similar to histology, not as high resolution images as histology. It's just an 1 micron resolution, and IVUS has about 150 to 200 micron resolution. But the images, tomographic images, are similar to histological sections. And these images are oriented from the ostium of the coronary artery. If you take example of echocardiography or computer tomography, all the images are oriented from the foot end of the patient. Here the intravascular ultrasound images are oriented as if you're sitting inside the sinus of Valsalva and viewing into the ostium of the coronary artery. And there is no absolute anterior, posterior, right and left orientation to the images. We describe the images as if viewing the face of the clock. We just explain some abnormality extending from 2 o'clock to 5 o'clock position, or something extending from 7 to 10 o'clock position. That is how you describe the abnormalities in IVUS images. And we use side branches and perivascular landmarks such as pericardium, muscle tissue, and the venous system to orient ourselves inside the coronary artery. So this is how we orient ourselves. And we see some of the, so how does this normal coronary artery appear on intravascular ultrasound imaging? We all know coronary artery has a lumen and a three-layered vessel wall architecture. This lumen appears echolucent with red speckles. You can just see that small white red spots of red speckle. Otherwise, it is mostly echolucent. It has the catheter in the middle. If you have a solid state system, the guide wire runs through the center of the catheter. You don't see any guide catheter artifact. Suppose if you are using a mechanical system, the guide wire runs outside the catheter. If you remember the first image I showed, so you see a wire artifact in that image. And then comes the three-layered vessel wall architecture. The inner layer is intima, which is rich in collagen and elastin. So it reflects sound intensely. So this layer appears bright. The second layer is media, mainly made up of smooth muscles. Smooth muscles doesn't reflect the sound. Sorry, I just told light, it is actually sound. It doesn't reflect the sound intensely. So that results in darker image in IVUS. The third is, again, it is adventitia, rich in collagen, seeds of collagen forms this adventitia, brightly reflect the sound, so again, a brighter structure. So it forms the brighter inner layer, intima, darker middle layer, that is media, and outer bright layer, that is the adventitia. So bright, dark, bright, that is the normal appearance of the vessel wall on IVUS imaging. As we all know, atherosclerosis is a disease of intima. With the development and progression of atherosclerosis, plaque accumulates in the intima and the intimal thickness gradually increases. This is a typical appearance of a diseased artery, and the echogenicity of this plaque depends on its constituents, whether it is made up of lipid or it's made up of fibrous tissue or it's made up of calcium. So this is how this plaque develops. So this is typical example of a glaucoma. So you can just see that the plaque material develops and gradual lumen narrowing, and everything is located in the intimal space. And the plaque can accumulate concentrically. That means it goes around the circumference of the vessel, or it can be eccentrically. It occupies only part of the circumference. Here, this is an example of concentric plaque, and here, this is an example of an eccentric plaque. We need to understand some of the terminologies before going to image interpretation. The first terminology is blood speckle. I already have shown some examples. So here you can just see blood speckles are nothing but finely textured echoes moving in swirling pattern. The two types of blood speckles, can you see here, this is an LAD artery. The blood speckles are much darker. That means blood is flowing faster. So the ultrasound has less time to interact with the blood speckles, and the blood RBCs are distributed sparsely. And here you can just see another example. This is an occluded diagonal branch after LAD stenting. The blood speckles are bright. That means blood is not moving, and it is there is a stasis of blood inside the vessel. So that results in more RBCs in the same space and more time for an ultrasound to interact with it. So that produces brighter speckles. When you have a high resolution imaging catheter, that means it is a 45 or 60 megahertz catheter, the blood speckles usually appear much brighter. Comparing to artery, the veins have much brighter speckles because the blood moves much slower in veins. Okay, this is an example of dark gray speckle, that means of fast moving blood, and this is an example of bright speckle, that means it is stagnant blood, so or slow moving blood. The second terminology is pericardium. Here you can see that stripe of tissue which moves through and fro with systole, and it shows the spoke like reverberations. Dark stripe of tissue, spoke-like reverberations, and back and forth movement with cardiac cycle is your pericardium. And the echoes free space that appears uniformly dark is pericardial space. The pericardial space is an echoes free space around the coronary artery. So this is a typical example of pericardium, and this is a typical example of the pericardial space. And what is the venous structure here? You can just see that the structure here from 1 o'clock to 4 o'clock or 5 o'clock position. And just this is an oval structure which exhibits systolic compression, which runs either parallel or perpendicular to the artery and doesn't join it. So that is a typical definition of a vein on IVUS image. And again, the blood speckles will be brighter because the blood moves slower in the vein. And how do you differentiate it from side branch? Side branch is the one which joins the main vessel. Here, this is a typical example of the side branch. Okay, next one. And now we see some of the examples of different arteries. First, we'll start with left main coronary artery. You see the left main coronary artery, it originates from the left coronary sinus and it runs through the transverse sinus behind the pulmonary artery and coming on the left side between your in the atrioventricular groove and divides into LAD and LCX. So what are the various lesions if it oblique aorta? So part of the ostium here, and this is your aorta, that marks your left main ostium. Ostium has the oblique aorta in its view. Then you move to the soft of the left main coronary artery. It travels through the transverse sinus. Transverse sinus is nothing but a pericardial space that is formed by reflection of pericardium from the great arteries to the surface of the heart. So this is your typical transverse sinus. Transverse sinus marks the middle part or soft of the left coronary artery. The distal part is marked by bifurcation into LAD and LCX. And another pericardial space that I'll show you later. So ostium, it is aorta, and middle part relation is transverse sinus, and the distal part, it is the bifurcation. So what are the various relations of the left anterior descending artery? You all know left anterior descending artery runs in the anterior intraventricular groove and is related anteriorly to the pericardium, posteriorly to the myocardium, on the left side to LCX and diagonal branches, and the major anterior intraventricular vein, which is again on the left side, and the septal branches comes on the myocardial side because it perforates and directly goes into the septal muscle, and the diagonal LCX, which comes on the left side. So these are the various relations of the left anterior descending artery. And here you just take it here. This is the ostial part of the left anterior descending artery. Here, this ostial and proximal part of the LAD along with the proximal part of your LCX and the reflection of the great cardiac vein from the anterior intraventricular groove into the left atrioventricular groove forms a triangular pericardial space. This pericardial space is called triangle of Bruchen-Moschett. The anatomist who identified this pericardial space that is called by their name. So this triangle defines your ostial part of the LAD. Here you can just see that the LCX and the LAD, and this is the pericardial space. This is called triangle of Bruchen-Moschett, and this is a constant landmark at the ostium of the LAD. And what happens to the mid and distal part of the LAD? The distal part of the LAD is usually accompanied by two venous structures. So here you can just see that produces an owl eye appearance here. This is your artery with your IVUS catheter, and this is one of the anterior intraventricular veins and another anterior intraventricular vein, which is on the right side, this is on the left side. And it is covered anteriorly by pericardium, bright stripe of tissue with spoke-like reverberation artifacts. And here you can just see that echolocation to myocardium. So this is myocardium, this is pericardium, this is right anterior interventricular and left side of anterior interventricular vein. And this is your mid and distal part of the LAD. And your septal branch comes on the myocardial side. And the diagonal branch comes on the left side. And your LCX again comes on the left side. So these are the various relations of left anterior descending artery. And how do you differentiate between diagonals and septal? See these examples here. These diagonal branches usually run along with LAD for a distance. And so when you see with IVUS, there's the diagonal branch often seen in the far field. You see the branch in the far field and gradually moves towards the LAD on your pullback. And this diagonal branch is located about 90 degree of angle to the pericardium. If you see, pericardium will be on the anterior surface. If it comes on the left side from the side, so it is 90 degrees from the pericardium. And it is about 90 to 180 degrees from the left septum, septal branches, because this diagonal branches come from the surface when you move very distally, where the artery moves deeply into the myocardium. So it is separated 90 degrees once it is on the side. When it comes from the anterior surface, it is about 180 degrees separated from the septal branches. And how do you identify septal branches? You all know the septal branches, they just originate and go perpendicularly into the myocardium. So the branch which has a wider angle from the LAD, which is more perpendicular, and appears to just bud away from the LAD abruptly. Can you see that? Just bud away from the LAD rather than seeing from the far field and comes in joints, and it comes on the myocardial side. So this is how you differentiate between diagonals and the septal branches on IVUS imaging. And what are the relationship of the LCX? Here you just see that the and do both the interventricular veins join to form a single interventricular vein, which is on the left side, which becomes a great cardiac vein and gets reflected into the left atrioventricular groove. This great cardiac vein lies on the atrial side of your LCX. So this is how it just hugs around your LCX. This is your great cardiac vein. A branch which comes towards the great cardiac vein is your atrial branch. A branch which goes away from your great cardiac vein is your marginal branch. This is an example of marginal branch, great cardiac vein, which comes in the opposite direction. So these are the various relationships of your LCX. Now what happens in RCA? We have seen that in LAD and LCX, the venous structures move parallel to the artery. Here, the venous structures move perpendicular to the artery. That produces horseshoe-shaped appearance of venous structure in RCA. The marginal branches just goes along with the venous structures. So this is a horseshoe-shaped appearance. It just goes perpendicular to the main artery. It goes along the marginal branch. So this is the appearance you get in when you image RCA with IVUS. So what are the basic characteristics you use for IVUS, grayscale IVUS characterization? We use five parameters. One is echogenicity. Echogenicity, in which the adventitial echogenicity serves as your reference. Just to say whether it is more, equal, or less echogenic comparing to adventitia. Second one is shadowing. Shadowing, we have already explained, it is complete reflection of the sound waves from the surface. So that results in poor visibility of deeper structure, that is called shadowing. Attenuation is, again, we have explained previously, that is the reduction in the intensity of sound waves as they pass through the tissue due to absorption, scattering, and reflection. That is what is the penetration depth. The fourth one is reverberation, that we are going to explain a little later. So the reverberations are nothing but ghost images from repetitive reflections of ultrasound waves. Then fifth characteristic is endymal thickness. Less than 300 is normal thickness. 300 to 600 is a physiological endymal thickening. That is the thickening which happens due to physiological response to stress. And more than 600 microns indicates pathological endymal thickening or fibroatheroma. So these are the five features. One is echogenicity. Second one is shadowing. Third one is attenuation. Fourth one is reverberation. Fifth one is endymal thickening. So now we start our image interpretation. You see a plaque here. What is echogenicity? So this is your adventitia and this is your plaque. Both have similar echogenicity. That is your fibrous plaque. So isoechoic is fibrous plaque. And you see the tissue here. See what is echogenicity here? It is hyperechoic comparing to adventitia. What addition you see? You are seeing only the leading edge of the plaque and deeper shadowing. The third thing, you can just see that ghost, some ghost artifacts here. So these are all called reverberation, that is resulting from repeated reflections. If you see these three features, one is it is plaque, which is hyperechoic adventitia, dorsal shadowing, and reverberation, that is your fibrocalcific plaque. Your plaque here, you just see in contrast to these things, this is hypoechoic and this is hyperechoic, which is hypoechoic comparing to adventitia, that is called the soft plaque. Most probably these contain more of lipid material. The two special type of soft plaques, first one is attenuated plaque. Attenuated plaque means isoechoic plaque. This is an isoechoic plaque with a deep signal loss. So isoechoic plaque with a deep signal attenuation is your attenuated plaque. This attenuated. Then second special type of plaque is echolocation plaque. Here you can just see a plaque with intra-plaque echolucency. This is called echolocation plaque. And these two, three plots are very important. These are very important determinant of slow flow or no flow and periprocedural myocardial infarction during PCI. And the plots we commonly see are mixed ones, where none of the components make up more than 85% of the plaque material. So this is what we see is mixed plots. You see that calcium, soft elements, and fibrous elements, typical example of a mixed plaque. And what you see here is a plaque, typical example of plaque rupture. So what is plaque rupture? Plaque rupture is nothing but intra-plaque cavity with the communication to the lumen. So this is your lumen, and this is your plaque, and this is your cavity inside the plaque, and this is your fibrous cap remnants. And you can just see the small thrombosis sitting inside. So this is a typical appearance of the ruptured plaque and the resulting ACS. And the next one you see here, you can see a structure which is an intraluminal, freely mobile mass with clear separation from the indimal layer. So this is your typical IVUS appearance of thrombus. So this completes the basic interpretation of different morphologies. So based on the echogenicity of adventitia as a reference, isoechoic fibrous tissue, hyperechoic with shadowing and reverberation is fibrocalcific tissue, hypoechoic is soft plaque, isoechoic plaque with deep signal attenuation is attenuated plaque, and a plaque with intra-plaque echolucency is echolocation plaque. A plaque with more than one characteristic is mixed plaque. A plaque with intra-plaque cavity with communication to your lumen is a plaque rupture. A freely mobile intraluminal mass with clear separation from the with the indimal layer is the thrombus. Okay, this is the most important slide what we are going to show today. And something more about attenuated plaque. What is the importance of attenuated plaque? I already explained. When you have signal attenuation in the deeper part, so here these two are examples of deeper signal attenuation, you usually have lipid or early necrosis. If the attenuation is superficial, they have advanced necrotic plaque or thin cap fibroathiroma. So these are the ones, thin cap fibroathiroma, and the big necrotic core, these are the ones resulting in no reflow. So deeper ones is either pathological indimal thickening, that is the earliest atherosclerotic abnormality, or early fibroathiroma, either lipid or early necrotic core. Superficial attenuation is late necrotic core with advanced fibroathiroma, and very superficial ones with a thin layer is thin cap fibroathiroma. However, IVUS doesn't have resolution to measure the fibrous cap, that is indirectly evidenced by this attenuation which is closer to the tumor. And how do you classify fibrocalcific plaque? Based on their location, it is a different, it is classified into superficial, which is closer to the lumen. This is superficial calcium, which is closer to the lumen. And the second one is deeper calcium, which is closer to the adventitia. So this is deeper calcium and this is your superficial calcium. How do you quantify calcium? By measuring the arc it encompasses. So here, this calcium encompasses 200 degrees along the circumference. So this is how you classify calcium. And the two special varieties of calcium. First one is called spotty calcium fatty calcium is nothing but a calcium which substance less than 90 degree of the vessel circumference. So this one is called spotty calcification. So this is the histological appearance of a spotty calcification. The second one is a protruding calcification, otherwise called as a nodular calcification. These two, even though calcium is considered a sign of stability, these two type of calcifications are associated with the plaque instability and plaque fibrous cap disruption and ACS. So these two, one is spotty calcification and the calcium nodule. And typically when it causes ACS, it is called as the eruptive calcified nodule. That means calcium just erupting through the fibrous capsule into the lumen. These two result in acute coronary syndrome. And see this example, here you can just see an angiogram showing multiple flap-like appearance. We usually call it as spontaneous coronary dissection, but with IVUS imaging and OCT imaging, we now know that most of these things are recanalized thrombi. So recanalized thrombi is nothing but, thrombus is nothing but an intraluminal mass with the multiple channels. You can see that multiple channels is typically called as lotus root or Swiss cheese appearance. This is a longitudinal view showing multiple channels. So this is the typical appearance of recanalized thrombus. And some of the specific morphologies that are specific to chronic total occlusion. In chronic total occlusion, the lumen is occluded or lumen is filled with the endymal plaque. So there is no lumen at all. It is occluded with the endymal plaque. So when you say that you have passed your wire from true to true, you're actually going through the endymal plaque. How does it appear? This blue part is your endymal plaque, and this is your white part is your media, and this is your adventitia. So when you are saying that you are going through true to true, you are actually going through the endymal plaque. How does it appear in IVUS? Here you can just see the three-layer vessel wall architecture. The whole thing is endymal plaque. Your wire is going to the center, and this is your IVUS catheter. So this is a typical appearance of a true to true or endymal plaque tracking on IVUS. Second, you are not going through endymal plaque. The second space you go through is, that is a common thing we do every day, is the subendymal space. Subendymal space is nothing but passage of wire in the medial space. The one peculiarity of medial space is it just expands easily by your wire movement. It just expands circumferentially and longitudinally by your wire movement. So this is a typical appearance of a wire in the subendymal space. This is a wire with your IVUS catheter. This crescent-shaped structure is your hematoma. And this round structure is your collapsed endymal plaque. You have gone through here, and this space accumulated a lot of blood, and this endymal plaque is collapsed to one side. So this is a typical IVUS appearance here. And this is your collapsed endymal plaque and your IVUS catheter in the subendymal space or in the medial space. And this crescent shaped structure is your hematoma. So this is your hematoma with IVUS catheter, and this is your collapsed endymal plaque. So this is the typical appearance of the endymal wire passage. Once you cross and goes into the distal part, either you will be in the luminal space, that is here, or in the subendymal space. Here, this is called as false lumen because you have a lumen here, there's no occlusion. So this is called false lumen and this is called true lumen. Once you enter the false lumen, how does it appear? Once you enter the false lumen, again, the true lumen collapses to form a bean-shaped structure. How do you differentiate true from false? A true lumen is a three-layer structure. Here you can see that endyma, media and adventitia. This is a three-layer structure that differentiates true lumen from the false lumen. Your IVUS catheter here is in the false lumen. False lumen is a single-layer structure. So these are the various morphologies you see during CTO intervention. And what is the dissection? Dissection is nothing but breach in the lumen continuity. Here you can just see this is your lumen continuity, and there is a breach in it. So this is a typical appearance of a dissection. how do you classify a dissection based on the axial extent? It is into intima or into the media or into the adventitia. So intimal dissection, medial dissection, or adventitial dissection. And based on the circumferential extent, so that is quantified by how many degrees along the circumference it occupies. You say that 60 degree dissection, 80 degree, 100 degree dissection. In the longitudinal plane, how long it extends, about 3 millimeter, 5 millimeter, like that. So this is how we quantified and qualified dissections. We have to tell, we have to specify three informations: what is axial extent, what is the circumferential extent, and what is the longitudinal extent. And what is intramural hematoma? Intramural hematoma is the accumulation of blood in the medial space, commonly results from balloon dilatation or stenting. So it is a continuation of dissection. There is no space, where in plain dissection there is space for this hematoma to move distally into the vessel, so it doesn't accumulate inside. When one side it is closed, it causes hematoma. So what is the typical appearance? Here you can just see that this is your medial space and this is your lumen. You see, this carefully follow this media, it's split into two. This is part of media and this is part of media, and accumulation of blood in the medial space. It is an intravascular accumulation of the blood. This all the bright things are RBCs, densely packed inside your medial space. So this is a typical appearance of the intravascular or intramural hematoma. Here it is lumen and your blood is still in the intravascular space. And here this is an example of extravascular hematoma. Here this is your lumen and this is your vessel architecture. There is a breach in the architecture. The blood accumulates in the peri-adventitial space. So this is your extravascular hematoma. This is intravascular and this is your extravascular hematoma. Okay, what is malposition? Malposition is lack of contact between stent studs and the vessel wall, with movement of RBCs in between. You just see that stent studs here, and this is your intimal surface and movement of RBCs. So this is the typical appearance of your malposition. And you have a special function with the Vulcano system. So where you can see the Doppler movement outside the stent studs. So this is function is called chromaflow. It exists only with the solid state system of Phillips. And what is the tissue prolapse? The tissue prolapse is nothing but prolapse of the atherothrombotic material, prolapse of the atherothrombotic material into the stent. So that is your tissue prolapse. It contains either the atherosclerotic material or the thrombus. So this is a typical appearance of tissue prolapse. You can just see that this is your stent and this is all prolapsing material between the stent studs. This is a case that done in an SVG graph. Can just see that angiographically how much it is narrowed. You can see the stent, only a trickle of flow, and all the remaining are prolapsed tissue. This is a longitudinal view showing the prolapsed tissue inside. You can just see the extensive prolapse of the atherothrombotic material inside the stent. And what is muscle bridge? Here you can just see that this is a typical angiographic appearance of muscle bridge, and here you can just see that the muscle layer goes around the artery. You can just see from here, it goes around the artery. The artery exhibits systolic squeezing motion. So this patient was given a lot of inotropes. So this is accentuated the systolic compression. So this is a typical appearance of a muscle bridge. And what is coronary aneurysm? We define coronary aneurysm with IVUS in the same way as we define with the coronary angiography. So aneurysm is a part which is more than 1.5 times the diameter of that of reference segment. So this is a typical appearance of aneurysm. So IVUS helps in differentiating between true aneurysm, where you see all three layers intact. When there is a breach in the vessel wall continuity, that is a false aneurysm or pseudo aneurysm. that can be easily identified with your IVUS. And what is a remodeling? Remodeling is a change in the vessel size at the lesion site comparing to the reference segments. If it is bigger, it is called a positive remodeling. And if it is smaller, it is called a negative remodeling. So these two reference segments, disease segment is smaller, that is negative remodeling, that appears typically in chronic stable angina patients. Here you just see that this is bigger than the reference, this is positive remodeling, usually occurs in ACS patients. One word about radiofrequency IVUS. This grayscale IVUS uses only the envelope information in the reflected signals, and its discriminatory power is limited. To improve the tissue discriminatory power, this newer systems uses radio frequency signals behind this envelope for tissue characterization. There are three such algorithms developed by different companies. This is algorithm from Philips that is called virtual histology, which is based on the spectral analysis of the samples that is collected from the cadavers. So based on this, it has developed an algorithm that codes tissues with the different colors. The second one is IMAP, that is based on pattern recognition of the spectral similarity with the reference samples. The third, this is from Boston Scientific. And the third one is integrated backscatter, that is from Thermo IVUS, that uses average power of the backscattered signals. Among these three, only the virtual histology is extensively validated. It color codes different tissues with specific colors. Dark green, fibrous tissue is coded with dark green. Fibrofatty tissue is coded with light green. Necrotic tissue is red, and the calcium is white. So this improves the discriminatory power of your IVUS. Even though it came in big way, we don't use it in routine practice because it doesn't have much of value in our routine application. So this completes image interpretation. Now we move into the last part of the presentation, that is image artifacts. It is very, very important to understand this image artifacts to mistake it for normal anatomical or pathological structures. The first abnormality is a non-uniform rotational distortion. This is unique to mechanical systems. So that results from mechanical binding of the drive cable that rotates the transducer. That results in circumferential distortion or smearing of the image. As you know, the transducer has to go around the 360 degree to produce image. If the part of the rotation is constrained, that produces this onion peel-like appearance that is called non-uniform rotational deformation because it results from the non-uniform rotation of the transducer. It is caused by tightening of your hemostatic valve. If it is too tight, that results in hindrance to the rotation of the IVUS catheter. When you use tortuous or small guiding catheters, using a 5-French guiding catheter or using a guide catheter with multiple curves such as Amplatzer catheters. When there is an acute bend in the artery or when there is a tight calcific stenosis, and most commonly in our setup, it results from defective imaging catheter because of the repeated use or kinking of the imaging sheath. All these things, few are correctable with your techniques and few are not correctable. So all this is the results in non-uniform rotational deformation. The clinical importance, it impairs the circumferential resolution. You are not able to see what is happening this part of the circumference of the artery. And again, it makes the measurements unreliable because you can't see where exactly the endymal surface ends. So this is the clinical importance of non-uniform rotational distortion. It doesn't occur in paced error system because it doesn't have a rotating element. And the second one is true and fro artifacts. When you are doing an IVUS imaging in AV groove arteries, that is RCA and LCX, they move vigorously during cardiac cycle. That result in movement of the catheter relative to the artery before one circle image is formed. So whatever you get in the image is combination of two circles. You get these type of image, rather than a single circle image. That makes your measurements unreliable. And the third one is, this is one other most important thing you have to recognize, that is the guide catheter artifact. Here you can just see that guide catheter is deeply encased into the artery. And you should not mistake this one for a calcified plaque at the ostium. So this is an image when the guide catheter is inside, and this is an image when the guide catheter is removed. So you should not mistake it for calcium at the aorto-ostium junction. And another thing is ring down artifact. Ring down artifact is nothing but bright halos of various thickness surrounding the surface of the catheter. So this is a typical ring down appearance. It results from acoustic oscillation, that is high frequency oscillation closer to the surface of the transducer. So what is the clinical importance? It creates a zone of uncertainty. In a bigger vessel, it doesn't make a big difference. When you are imaging a smaller vessel, this ring down that impairs your capacity to identify the abnormalities closer to the vessel. Suppose you take a tighter stenosis which is hugging the IVUS catheter, you'll be mixing this part of the information. So the system produces something called ring down suppression function. So that removes this ring, but still suppresses the information closer to the catheter. So this is the typical appearance of a ring down artifact. The blood speckle artifact, when there is a stasis or when you are using a high frequency catheter, the blood speckles appear much brighter. So it impairs your capacity to identify the lumen edema interspace. If you want to see this one clearly, you have to either inject contrast or saline to remove the blood speckles. Here, this is an example after injection of saline. You can just see, identify the interface clearly. And this shadowing. Shadowing occurs when all the ultrasound waves reflected from the surface. So this is the shadowing which results from calcium. Calcium intensely reflects the ultrasound signals. So that results in shadowing of the deeper structures. The other structures which cause shadowing are your air bubbles and stent sets, and your guide wires. The guide wires are again metal structures. They reflect the ultrasound based on the surface that causes shadowing. So these are the common causes of the shadowing in IVUS imaging. The air bubble. Air bubble is the biggest enemy of IVUS imaging. And air trapping in the sheath and IVUS catheter. Again, it occurs with the mechanical catheter. It doesn't occur with solid state system because there is no sleeve around the catheter in solid states. You can just see the poor image quality. When you flush it, the image quality improves. You can cause another abnormalities like the diffuse bright appearance. You cannot identify anything. This can also be produced by presence of air bubbles inside. And air bubbles can cause the prominent reverberations artifacts also. So multiple artifacts can be caused by presence of air bubbles. So you have to clearly flush, dedicatedly flush the catheter to remove all the air bubbles to avoid these type of abnormalities. And reverberation. Reverberation is nothing but repeated reflections between the catheter and the highly reflective surface. Suppose you take a metal stent set or a calcium. So the impulses get repeatedly reflected between this surface and the transducer. So the system counts each reflection as multiple times it has traveled. So if it travels two times, that means it traveled two times the depth. So it produces another image exactly twice the distance. And again, if it reflects three times, it forms another ghost image at the exact three times the distance between these two structures. So that is the, so what is the clinical importance? You should not mistake this one for a different interface. You should not think that there are three interfaces here. It's actually in one interface of calcium that has produced a reverberation of multiple interfaces. These are all ghost shadows. You should not think that there are multiple interfaces. I guess more commonly with calcium. When you do rotablation, it paralyzes calcium. The reverberation becomes more prominent. And this is your guide catheter. Guide catheter is another one which produces prominent reverberation. So this is the guide catheter related reverberation. And this one is stent stud related reverberation. You can just see that multiple pairs of stents. Here actually there is only one layer. These are all artifacts. And this is your guide wire. related reverberation, and this is your air bubble related reverberation. These are the various things which can cause reverberation artifacts in IVUS imaging. And what is side lobe artifact? Usually the main lobe is the one which results in formation, which contributes to the formation of the image. These side lobes are usually inosseous. When they encounter strong reflecting surfaces like stained edges or calcium, they too result in contribute to the formation of the image. This follow the circumferential sweep that actually results in extension of stained edges or extension of your calcium. This produces a false appearance of malapposition of stained edges. This produces false appearance of a dissection closer to the calcified block. So you should keep this side lobe artifact in mind to misinterpret this as a malapposition and this as a dissection. This is nothing but an artifact. And lastly, what is a stent ghost artifact? Stent ghost are reflections from stent metals from the opposite side from the true structures. So you should not, it make it difficult to distinguish from the true structure malapposition. So this is a typical ghost artifact of stent stents. This is actually a reflection from the opposite side. It's not the true structure. So you should not mistake this one for stent malapposition. This completes the presentation of image interpretation. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Doctor. I think 1 hour is not sufficient for this, but I think we need to keep some more session. There are some questions which I just wanted to take it up to you, Doctor.
The first
question is, does tissue prolapse after DES need restenting?
So it depends on amount of tissue prolapse. Actually, there is no definite criteria. The lumen is lumen. That means the remaining area inside the stent is big enough for the blood to flow. You don't have to do anything, just leave it alone. So the different criteria have been proposed. The first criteria was proposed by Harrison AMI trial that considered adequate lumen is 4 mm². We have a flow area less than 4 mm², you have to do additional intervention. Either you do suction, you do prolonged low pressure balloon dilatation, or if it still remains and occlusive, you have to put an additional stenting.
Okay.
And an additional criteria is defined in Illumin 3 study, which consider adequate lumen as more than 90%, at least 90% of the reference lumen area. And practically, if you feel that lumen area is not adequate, you have to do adequate this thing with the balloon dilatation, aspiration, or additional stenting.
Fine. That is one more question, Doctor. Can we use IVUS in carotid artery also?
Yeah, we can use dedicated peripheral IVUS catheters are available. So you can use similar way for carotid also. But the issue is most of the times radiologists use our Doppler imaging, ultrasound Doppler probes to image the arteries from externally to characterize the plaques rather than using an IVUS. But IVUS can be very much useful in carotid artery imaging too.
And one more question, a ring down artifice is common. How to avoid this?
So you can't avoid it because it is common, most commonly occurs with the solid state system. The manufacturer gives a function called the ring down suppression. So you have to do ring down suppression before you start your imaging. So that is how you can avoid it.
Okay. And how to measure vessel size?
Yeah, that is a different topic. I didn't touch it because I thought maybe that we'll do it with the intervention session. So you measure, so if you see an artery, normal non-stented artery, let's just show you an example here. You take this example here. If the artery is non-stented, there are two interfaces. First one is your lumen intima interface. If you measure here, what you get is lumen measurement. Either area or it can measure diameters, that is your lumen measurement. And the second interface is external elastic membrane interface, that is where the adventitia starts. Then that is how, if you measure this area, that gives you vessel dimension, either vessel area or vessel diameters. That is your external elastic membrane area. That measurement is made at the junction of the media with adventitia.
Okay. How to correctly identify lumen vessel wall interface when there is a significant blood speckles?
You have to inject contrast or saline to remove the blood speckles. Then you can, I showed an example here. So this is your typical blood speckle artifact. Let me see that here. So this is what happens when you have a tight stenosis or stasis. So you cannot identify the lumen intima interface here. This after injection of contrast, you can clearly identify the lumen intima interface.
How to differentiate between the shadow and side lobe?
Side lobe is an additional image. It is not in shadow. Side lobe, usually it is similar to what you do in regular echocardiographic imaging. Usually the main beam is the one which forms the image. Suppose you have a highly reflective surface and the side lobes, usually they do not participate in image formation. When they get reflected from these edges, they form additional image. They also contribute image by extension of this tensors or calcium that appears as along the circumferential sweep, that appears as an elongation of stencil or elongation of calcium. This produces a false appearance of malposition. This produces a false appearance of the dissection. This is actually an image. In shadow, there is no image. Shadow occurs when there is a dominant reflection from the surface. None of the ultrasound waves goes through further, where you can see only the leading edge. So all these things are shadow. So that is the difference between shadow and your side lobe. Side lobe is actually an image. Shadow, there is no image.
And one more question, where to use OCT and where to use IVUS?
Depends on your prominent work. If you do more of ACS work, or more of a bifurcation, and where this is resolution is very important, or three-dimensional imaging is important, OCT is better than IVUS. And your predominant work is left main intervention, your CTO intervention, IVUS is better than OCT imaging. And the post-stent assessment, and both IVUS and OCT are equally good.
How to choose the size of the stent diameter bracket? Diameter by lumen area or vessel area?
So two ways of selecting your stent. If you are using the external elastic membrane dimension of the reference, not the lesion, if you are using the external elastic membrane diameter as your reference, you have to undersize the stent to the nearest 0.25. The mean external elastic membrane diameter at the reference is 3.5 millimeter. You have to put a 3.25 millimeter or a 3 millimeter stent. If you are using the lumen reference at the reference, lumen reference, you have to upsize by 0.25. Suppose your mean lumen diameter is 3.25 millimeter, you have to put a 3.5 stent. Upsize to the nearest 0.25 in case of lumen dimension. Downsize to the nearest 0.25 millimeter in case of external elastic membrane based selection. Yeah, thank you so much for arranging this. It is a wonderful experience for me. Maybe if time permits in near future, we may do one on how to use IVUS to do intervention. Thank you so much. Thanks for organizing this.
Thank you so much. So there was a fantastic participation of